Thank you for the opportunity to speak and to come to your wonderful city and the nice weather that you have compared to Sacramento, where we need the rain. I'm going to speak mostly about easel painting today, and I'm not going to give too many details in my lecture about the history or the individual artists or things like that, but you can ask me questions later if you like, and if I know the answer, I will give it to you. But instead, I would like to share some insights with you about the connections between war and revolution as it pertains to easel painting in Russia between 1914 and 1923. And I will just show a few select paintings, about a half a dozen, and talk a little bit about them in the context of this, these insights. And you can ask me again if you would like to know any specific details, but I will leave the details of the politics and the history out. Maybe that's not the right thing to do, but I think in the interest of brevity and to focus the talk, I will just talk about the art and how it relates to the changes that are caused by the economic and social and political changes of this period. One of the things to remember about Russia in the First World War and during the Revolution is that we can really talk about the period 1914 to 1923 as a unit from a certain perspective, right? In other words, Russian historians and people who have looked at history have tended to put the dividing line in history at 1917 with the Revolution, but I would like to push it back a little bit to 1914 and forward a little bit to 1923 to show how there were connections and commonalities between the First World War, the period of the First World War, and the period of the Revolution, and to try and erase a little bit that sharp dividing line of 1917, which is not a new idea, but one that I think that the art history shows very, very nicely, at least as I explain it. And one thing about this period from 1914 to 1923, and later, and before, but really striking, is that artists changed their art and their ideas about art as the social and economic and public conditions changed radically around them, starting in 1914 and continuing on through the Revolution. And what they did more specifically, or at least what I'll emphasize, is that they sought a new stability in a period of instability. In other words, with the outbreak of the First World War, the regularity and the predictability of life in Imperial Russia for the artist suddenly changed. It became different. It became unstable. It became unpredictable. And when 1917 came around, it became even more unpredictable and seriously fractured. And so this is the characteristic that artists are responding to, both as people and also as artists, and what the kinds of things that they represent in their work. So that's the thread that goes between 1914 and 1923. And elides in some aspects the division of the revolution, which, by the way, is still there. I'm not going to say the revolution was not important. I'm just going to say that there are commonalities between the end of Imperial Russia from a cultural point of view, or even more narrowly, a point of view of art and easel painting that we shouldn't lose sight of. In fact, I will make the argument that one of the great revolutions in art actually took place before the revolution of 1917. It took place in late Imperial Russia, and that later became integrated into the early Soviet cultural scene and was reinterpreted as a politically revolutionary art, whereas during the latter period of Imperial Russian history, during World War I, it was seen as an aesthetic revolution. And that leads me to this, right? This is the aesthetic revolution, the black square. And probably the iconic representation of Russian avant-garde art now in European and in Russian culture. I don't know if you're familiar with it, but you're probably familiar with something like it, yes? Because many artists have followed, imitated, replicated this kind of thing, both in the United States in the 1950s and 1960s, and even today you'll find things like this. The Black Square from 1915. And sometimes people are very frightened by this image, right? Or they're repelled by it. Because it doesn't represent to them what art should be about. I'm sure this audience can handle it, so I'm showing it to you. But it's worth thinking about what this says about what art is about, which I'll try and explain a little bit. This is a revolutionary concept because it basically redefined what art was. For this artist, this was not a representation of anything. It's the first example of theoretical, non-objective art in European intellectual history, and I'll explain what that means in a minute, or maybe right now, right? Many of you it looks very abstract, right? It's just a black square on a white canvas. And I think this artist also did a white square on a white canvas. And there's triangles in some paintings and circles, various colors, right? So we're all familiar with that kind of abstract art. And in fact, abstract art had existed in Europe before World War I, so there's nothing really particularly revolutionary about this as an abstract painting. But this is a painting that's, from the artist's point of view, was not abstract. It was non-objective. And what I mean by that is the artist made very clear that this painting and the other artists who worked in this genre starting in 1915 in Imperial Russia argued that this was different than abstract art because it wasn't really art. It was a reality that they were creating, right? In other words, this does not represent a black square. What is it? It is a black square. It is the physical paint painted on the physical canvas, and that's all it is. In other words, for the non-objective artist, the work does not reflect anything outside of itself, right? It's not a representation of a peasant, right? Or a fish, or a black square somewhere else, or the idea of a black square, yes. I'll get to that in a minute. This is a good question, good question. There are many versions of this that don't have the cracks in them that are just black squares and triangles and circles and so on. But this represented the true power of the artist to create something new and not just reflect something outside of himself or herself, right? So it's not the idea of a black square. It is a black square painted on canvas. And this is a product not of the war, not of the revolution, but of the war. Obviously, the date gives it away. But I argue, or I will suggest, or I'll just tell you, that this really is a part of this search for stability. And that's why it emerges at this time, and why the artists and the critics and the other artists who are working in this area interpret it that way, right? They interpret it as something new, a new contribution to world history, a response to the instability of the modern world, especially in the time of war. It's, from a certain point of view, it's seen as an antidote to war. But there's a lot of other ways in which it does this. So what happened during the war in Russia for Russian artists? Very briefly, I'll just say that the Russian art world, especially the world of the avant-garde, was severely disrupted. People were conscripted, artists were conscripted, they went to war. Barriers to trade kept easel paint out that they used to get from Western Europe. The society mobilized itself to support art sales for charity and not regular art sales, among other things. eventually inflation came starting in 1915 pretty seriously and pretty much continuing throughout the rest of the war. And refugees came from the borderlands. And when they came to Moscow and other cities, what did they do with their money that they had? They purchased art to put into their new homes, right? So actually, one of the ironic things about the art world in Russia during World War I is that the art market took off, and artists became very interested in taking advantage of that. The avant-garde itself began to dissolve because it was made up mostly of young people, right? And many of them were conscripted, they moved around, and avant-garde artists sought to create a new style to show their power as artists, and that's clearly what Malevich is doing with his art. His new idea about art is to create a new reason to be for the avant-garde after it had kind of lost its ability to shock society and to actually kind of exist as it had before. But you don't have to necessarily know that. If you look at the actual figure, you'll see that the geometric patterns bring a sense of stability to the work. So from an aesthetic point of view, this very geometric style reflects a new sensibility for order, right, in a time of disorder. It also kind of represents an easy way to make paintings with limited capability. You point out the cracks, and if you x-ray this painting, which has been done, you'll find that underneath it there is another painting that the artist recycled, right? And so instead of throwing it away or giving away or selling it, canvas was limited, paint was limited, you recycled. And if your palette was limited, if you only had black, what did you paint with? Black. One artist wrote, "I only have red, so I paint in red." That simplifies things. And that's due to the after effects of the war and the shortages, the material shortages, and things like that. So I think that you can see even this very radical representation that if you look at it, you would think this has nothing to do with World War I at all. It really does have something to do with World War I. It's a material after effect, a material reaction to World War I. Some of the other works that were done during the war are much more obviously related to the war, right? More conventional war painting. So this is actually one of the most famous, or one of the major war paintings by a Russian avant-garde artist done during the war, and it's actually a huge monumental canvas that he painted over a year, took over a year to do it, 1915 and 1916. And you might look at this and say, well, this is kind of a conventional patriotic picture, right, of an artist who is concerned with depicting brave soldiers in battle. And if you thought that, you would be right, because the artist who painted this painting wanted to show the bravery and the power of the Russian soldier, the common Russian soldier, in battle. And that's not necessarily something that we think is new, but for this artist, it was new because he is an artist who had never, ever painted anything that depicted a contemporary event, right? He was a symbolist. He believed with the other symbolists of the early 20th century that art should be for art's sake, and you should not paint depictions of reality. But in the time of war, he felt moved by seeing soldiers. He felt his own patriotism. He wanted to tell a story, and so he changed his painting style to reflect what he saw as a real event for the first time in his career, and he wrote that. He said, "This is the first time that I've been engaged in a political question," when he painted this picture. He was seeking to engage a new audience because his fellow artists from his the World of Art group, his fellow aesthetes, hated this picture. They hated it because they said, "How can you betray our ideals and paint something that's common?" right, and worldly, and doesn't reflect the true reality of beauty of art. You know, is this a beautiful picture? I don't know. I think most people would say, I don't know what people would say about this picture. I have a hard time thinking myself what this picture is about. Clearly, it represents a sacrifice of a Russian soldier, right? The middle figure. But what else it shows, I'm not sure. You can see in the background the puffs of smoke. You can see some death. You can see maybe some determination on the part of the soldiers. But where they're going, if they are victorious, what happens to them, you don't really see. It's kind of a snapshot in time. And his colleagues hated this. The critics hated this. And they said, after this artist said, now it would be better to shoot me or hang me instead of showing this in public. Because the criticism from his colleagues was so strong that he had changed his aesthetic values to reflect something about the war that he felt. And that's something that was also new about the First World War and Russian artists. They became engaged with the war. They wanted to show it. They wanted to contribute to the war effort. Some of them did it visually. Some of them did it through charities, right? Some of them did it through various kinds of social action. Not many actually did it through war painting. This is one of the few depictions of combat. This artist actually wasn't in combat, so it's an imaginary depiction of combat, or what he imagines combat might be like. That's very important to remember when you think about the revolution, because that's one of the things that carried on to the revolution, the social engagement and engagement with the public that began in 1914 with patriotism, and in 1917 it turned towards politics and revolution. But the urge to engage society began really with World War I and the environment in Russia at that time. Well, things got worse. In 1917, the imperial government was swept away. It was replaced eventually by a socialist government. That socialist government had different priorities, a different sense of itself. And not only that, the disturbances in the political and social realm became deeper and deeper, right? The economy basically collapsed in 1918 and 1919. The country was overrun by civil war. So no more World War I, but a civil war took place, as many of you know already. And the state also collapsed in 1917 and 1918 to be reconstituted along slightly different lines and certainly different ideological lines. So as there were not many depictions of combat in World War I, there were not many depictions of the revolution, actually, by Russian easel painters, for reasons that I hope I'll get to. But this is one of the more famous ones, or one that later Soviet critics saw as being significant. Instead of depicting Lenin leading the revolution, right, this painter has sort of created an allegory about the revolution as, well, a new planet. But what exactly is happening with this planet, we don't know. Is it colliding with another planet, right? Is it a new dawn? Is it the dawn on a new planet, a collision between planets? And how are the people reacting? It's a little bit unclear. Are they afraid? Are they greeting it? Are they greeting it with joy? They see, are they, what are they doing? It's a little bit uncertain, actually, what's going on here. And this kind of reflects, I think, the perception of the revolution as this great force, a natural disaster, that follows in the wake of the war and on into the Civil War. In other words, the instability and the uncertainty about the future. What is the future of these people? According to this artist, nobody knows. Lenin is not going to ride in and save everybody. They could all be destroyed. Nobody really knows by looking at this. The artist himself had painted impressionist country scenes before this. This was quite a significant departure from, this is a way in which artists, he changed his style and his message to meet the demands of the new culture, right, that was emerging in the early 1920s. And I didn't bring examples of his previous work, but it's quite strikingly different. In truth, the Bolsheviks were not really interested in easel painting. Right? What the Bolsheviks were interested in was political agitation in public spaces. Right? So artists who wanted to work found work, for example, creating banners for public squares, right, and not painting and having shows in galleries or in the art market. The art market has pretty much collapsed by this time anyway. So in a sense, easel painting became less important, and the political depictions went to the streets, right, where you can also see some of the influence maybe of Malevich and his artists on the left side there, and other examples of avant-garde art that were easy to put up, easy to make, and easy to display to other people. So that's one of the first differences that the revolution brought, was really a different focus on where art takes place or where art should take place. It should be in the street. It should be in everyday life. It should be explaining the revolution to the people and not in a gallery or a museum or in a private person's home. And the second thing that was different about the, different effect of the socialist revolution was that the state became much more important. The support of the state as it pertained to giving artists professional capabilities, right, and opportunities. This is what they got paid to do. So what did they do? They did it. And it was much more difficult to make a living with easel painting if there's no art market. You have no paint, and the government really prefers this. Nonetheless, so you'll see that avant-garde artists volunteered to help with this new public propaganda, if you want to call it. They engaged the public through political tasks. Right? They received income from the state. They were able to survive in a time of instability and personal crisis, as well as in the depths of the economy, as the economy reached a trough in the 1920s. And I'm just going to show a few more paintings that show, I think, how artists during the early 1920s sought to depict and arrange and maintain a sense of stability in a time of uncertainty and instability, right? Here's another painting by Petr Votkin, by the same artist who did that combat scene. This is from 1920, showing Petrograd in 1918 as what? Well, certainly not a place of revolutionary agitation, sort of maybe as an Italian square, I don't know, with a Madonna and child in front, right? So the classical architecture lends a timelessness to it, a calm to it. There are people in the street, but they don't seem particularly angry or suffering. And of course, so there's no revolutionary violence here. There's no revolutionary leadership here. There is just the consolation, perhaps, of religion, right, of the Madonna for the viewer, or for the artist, actually, as well, himself. He said, when I see her, I am consoled about his own work. So it made him feel better to paint this painting, which is now a very famous painting. Actually, most of these are very famous. Other avant-garde artists used the look of the black square in their revolutionary agitation. This is a very famous poster, beat the whites with the red wedge, is what the writing says. Beat the whites with the red wedge. And I don't know if you would... the thing about this, or what's significant about this is that in the process of creating this abstract poster, the principle of non-objectivity is cast aside, because now this is an object. It represents something outside of itself, right? It is not a red wedge and a white square. It represents the political forces that are contending inside the country. And taking one of the sides to show how the reds will win, the whites will be defeated. And just in case you miss the message, it's written there so that you can get it. right? Stuff like this was very considered to be very effective because as a poster, you can see it from quite a distance, right? In the back, you can see it, right? And if you're illiterate, you might even be able to make sense out of this. You might not be able to make sense out of the black square, but you can make sense out of this. Maybe if you think about it, the red wedge will defeat the black, the white circle. So in this way, some of the radical innovations that were taking place in the later part of Imperial Russia were reintegrated and continued into the revolutionary period, but reinterpreted in a political way. And the aesthetic foundations of that were cast aside, right? And now it's just become an abstract design that shows a political point. I think I have about three more minutes, right? No, I have plenty of time. The final picture that I will show will be a painting by the same artist who wrote or created On the Line. This time, he is showing the effects of the battle after the Civil War, right? And with the victory of the Reds, right, that period of instability ends, at least that short period, smaller period of instability. And it becomes clear what the regime will be. It will be a communist regime. The Red Guards are the victors. And here you see them at the table commemorating or thinking about their fallen comrade. And in some respects, you can see this, or maybe in many respects, you can see that as a continuation of that original painting, right? Whereas this took place in Imperial Russia, and in fact, the artist, without a clear resolution, what the end would be, who would win, we don't know. What is the war even about? We don't know. The artist's wife actually wrote that this painting was represented the disorganization of Imperial Russia. I'm not sure if I would go that far to say. Maybe it does represent disorganization, but it certainly does not have a clear resolution, not as clear a resolution as his later work, right, which shows the battle over. Right, and the Red Army victorious. But also in the back, you can see almost the very same image of the soldier who has sacrificed himself. So in 1923, this artist has gone through the patriotic phase of supporting Imperial Russia to the patriotic phase of supporting the Soviet Union and showing the victory of the Reds, but also reflecting the sacrifice of the ordinary soldier in the background of this painting. And it looks like it's taking place in a tavern. So I am imagining these are kind of their thoughts or maybe their conversation as they're talking about this comrade who has fallen in the war. So I think that you can see the sacrifice of the dead has resulted in a peace, right? And a new time, a time of order and stability where the Red Army will be there. The peace has come, and the future is communist. And with that, I think I will end. And I will ask if you have any questions or if you would like to show some, I can go back and show some of these paintings if you'd like to talk about them or ask questions about them. Thank you.